What's the difference between existing and surviving? The reason I ask is that we're going to start this episode by jumping right into the word of the day, chosen Shengcun, which means, as I understand it anyway, to exist or to survive. This is the Sheng character, which means kind of like flow and birth. You might know it from, or I know it from Ren Sheng and Sheng Huo, two different words with subtle or not so subtle differences, which more or less mean life. And I can admit that probably another reason I have positive feelings about the word Sheng is I associate it with Sheng Pi, which means like draft beer. So that gives you an idea of where I was learning my Chinese when I lived in China. But anyway, the difference between existing and survival is something we might be considering in our conversation about our chosen book and author for this episode. It is Xuěmò's The Woman, the Camels, and the Dholes, which is taken from an audiobook. We're doing an audiobook this time, although this book does exist in print, and I think is an ebook as well. In any case, the book this story is taken from is Selected Stories. The Selected Stories of Xuěmò. And my guests are the producer of the audiobook and the voice actor whose voice you hear if you do indeed listen to that audiobook, Sarah Lam. Pretty sure this is the first time we've had an actor on the pod, so that in itself is very exciting, if you ask me. So I'll sign off there as far as philosophizing goes, and take us into the TrChFic news, the translated Chinese fiction news. It's just basically four recommendations this time of some things that you can check out. So the first recommendation or news item I'm going to shove into your ears is the Paper Republic Guide to Chinese Literature. They've actually gone and made a book, if you can believe it. So it's available to buy for £15 GBP. If you're in the UK, or you can get it in the US for $18, Canada for $25 Canadian dollars, CAD, that's funny, and $28 if you're in Australia. It's also available as an ebook in all the different Kindle stores. I won't bother reading all those prices, but yeah, I'll read one just for fun. You can get it off the Japanese Kindle store for 1,237 Japanese yuan. Yen, sorry, Chinese bias rearing its head there. So I'll just read the blurb for this thing. Paper Republic's Definitive Guide to Contemporary Chinese Literature, in translation, features detailed biographical entries covering almost, and then it's in bold text, so I'll do my bold text voice, 100 of the most important writers working in the Chinese language today. From Annie Baby, I think that's Annie Baobei, who we heard about from Harvey Tomlinson in the Murong episode, from Annie Baby to Zhang Yuanran by way of Nobel Prize winner Mo Yan. The biographies are complemented by in-depth and essays. Sorry, oh dear, essays is also bolded. Let's redo that. By in-depth essays. And then it's got some bullet points. Very nice bullet points. They are bullet point number one. Dylan Levi King assesses the changing role of the author in Chinese society. Then US-based academic Zhu Ping discusses women's writing in Chinese. Then translator and scholar Andrea Lingenfelter provides an introduction to the rich but often neglected field of Hong Kong literature. Yeah, that's something this podcast has really neglected, to be honest. We need to do more stuff from Hong Kong. Next bullet point. Emily Xueni Jin outlines the increasingly influential field of Chinese science fiction. The bold text voice is getting worse with each time I use it, I think. I'll see if I can pick up before this blurb ends. Next bullet point, Rachel Chung. Now this is the Canto spelling, C-H-E-U-N-G. I actually don't really know how to pronounce that, so sorry if I've pronounced that wrong. Rachel Chung brings us bang up to date with the latest in Chinese internet literature. Sorry about that. Final bullet point. A powerful introductory essay by Xiaoluo Guo, the Chinese-born UK-based novelist, gives a view from the inside. Right, I spent a lot of time on that one, didn't I? Let's go to the next news item. So this is something you can listen to. Actually, this is loads of different things you can listen to, because this guy I'm about to describe, I think, has been doing the rounds of the China podcastosphere, or at least a few different podcasts, not all China-focused podcasts, but it's the academic Professor Craig Clunas, a fellow Scot, I do believe, if his voice is anything to go by. And he's been talking about an exhibition that happened at the Freud Museum in London. What I have been to when I was last... No, sorry, not when I was last in London. When I was last in London for a significant... I was there for like a week. I was there too long. But I filled up my time with lots of museum visits. And one of the places I visited was the Freud Museum. So anyway, it's his old house, basically. I think it's the place where he died or where he lived. He spent his last years. But there was an exhibition there of like of his Chinese collection, all the sort of Chinese things he owned. And spoilers, the interesting thing about it is that it's not real antiques. It's a lot of fakes and stuff. And the other, like... This is a spoiler, I suppose, but he had books on his bookshelf about all the other sort of worldly antiques he had. I saw a collection. It was on the shelves and described in the museum. He had loads of stuff from like ancient Greece and Roman Mediterranean, Egypt, and he was like knowledgeable about that stuff, or at least he'd read it. But when it came to anything Chinese, he didn't really know much at all. So. In the podcast hosted by the Freud Museum and in various other podcasts, for example, on Chinese Whispers, which is under the umbrella of the Spectator magazine. It's terrible. I've forgotten the name of the host, but that's a good interview. I'm sure he's done some others on different pods. Basically, if you want to hear Craig Clunas talking about Freud's sort of non-connection with Chinese culture, but also he goes into how his ideas were sort of processed and absorbed, repressed, and then returned. I didn't plan to say repressed and returned, but there you go. That's just how much of a Freudian I am, how they were repressed and returned in the PRC. Just check it out. Again, I've linked to the page on the Freud Museum's website, but he's done at least, I think, two or three of these interviews on the interwebs. I think they're probably sort of all the same content, but with slight variations. I wonder if Freud had ideas about repetition. I think he did. I just can't think what they are. Okay, it's a very spirited news segment today, isn't it? I'm not normally this bouncy. I think it's just because I've just had my dinner. I had pasta. Okay, next news item. It's something you can listen/watch to. So you may have guessed already. It's an interview on YouTube, and it's between Jingzu and Dan Russell. I don't know who Dan Russell is, to be honest, but they're talking about Jingzu's new book, Kingdom of Characters, which I actually got for my birthday. I'll just read the blurby thing here, the video description. That'll do my job for me. What does it take to reinvent a language? After a meteoric rise, China today is one of the world's most powerful nations. Just a century ago, it was a crumbling empire with literacy reserved for the elite few. There's no bold text here, by the way, so you're only going to get my normal voice. As the world underwent a massive technological transformation that threatened to leave them behind. In Kingdom of Characters, Jingzu argues that China's most daunting challenge was a linguistic one, the century-long fight to make the formidable Chinese language accessible to the modern world of global trade and digital technology. Ooh, this is well written. Second paragraph. Kingdom of Characters follows the bold innovators who reinvented the Chinese language. Among them, an exiled reformer who risked a death sentence to advocate for Mandarin as a national language. A Chinese Muslim poet who laid the groundwork for Chairman Mao's phonetic writing system, and a computer engineer who devised input codes for Chinese characters on the lid of a teacup from the floor of a jail cell. Without their advances, China might never have become the dominating force we know today. With larger-than-life characters and unexpected perspective on the major events of China's tumultuous 20th century, Tzu reveals how language is both a technology to be perfected and a subtle yet potent power to be exercised and expanded. Oh, that was fun to read. And funnily enough, the interview is dated here in the description, and it was recorded on my birthday, the 24th of Feb, amusingly. But the video only just went up yesterday. Weirdly enough, I was just searching through YouTube for talks, anything to do with Chinese lit, and this one had gone up an hour before I started searching. So I'm going to say it's fate, the hand of fate, which will be coming up in our discussion about Xuěmò's work, funnily enough. Okay, the last thing, longish news segment today. So it's a book, and you should definitely check it out. Perhaps not if you're not wealthy, because this one costs £120 as a hardback, and the ebook is a bargain of £33.29. So if you may have guessed, if you know anything about publishing, this is an academic book. The pricing is designed to leech money out of libraries, university budgets, via their libraries' purchasing systems. The only economical way to read this thing would be if you've got academic access, presumably to download the chapters as PDFs. I think that would be the best way to get it. Or maybe wait a while and buy a second-hand copy. But all that, you know, grumbling about the broken academic publishing system aside, this is a book that is forthcoming. So it's coming out on March the 11th, which is 2 days away from the time of that I'm speaking into the microphone right now. So just to remind you, the book's called Eco-Criticism and Chinese Literature, Imagined Landscapes and Real Lived Spaces. So academic book, here we go. Focusing on eco-critical aspects throughout Chinese literature, particularly modern and contemporary Chinese literature, the contributors to this book examine the environmental and ecological dimensions of notions such as Qing and Jing. And if I knew the tones, you'd probably know which words I was talking about. Although maybe if you know your Chinese environmental and ecological vocab, you'll also be an advantage here. Anyway, continuing. Chinese modern and contemporary environmental writing offers a unique aesthetic perspective towards the natural world. Such a perspective is mainly ecological and allows human subjects to take a benign and non-utilitarian attitude towards nature. The contributors to this book demonstrate how Chinese literary ecology tends towards an ecological system holism from which all human behaviors should be closely examined. They do so by examining a range of writers and genres, including Liu Cixin's science fiction, Wu Mingyi's environmental fiction, and Zhang Chongzhi's historical narratives. I'm going to pause here. Something I didn't comment on the Paper Republic book is how many of those writers contributed essays at the start. How many of them have been on this podcast? It's just two, actually. It was Dylan Levi King and Emily Shuanyi Jin. But yeah, on that topic, here in this book, we're rattling off authors who've been covered on the show. We've done Liu Cixin, we've done Wu Mingyi, we have not done Zhang Chongzhi. Maybe we should do Zhang Chongzhi, but only if the books exist in translation. Anyway, continuing. This book provides valuable insights for scholars and students looking to understand how Chinese literature conceptualizes the relationship between humanity and nature, as well as our role and position within the natural realm. Whew! So, it's not all on one theme, which is why it's harder to write a great... Well, it is on one theme, but it's not all on one topic, so it's harder to write a really punchy blurb for it. So yeah, this is an interesting book. If you've got academic access, I suggest checking it out. If not, perhaps you should use cunning means, like, I don't know, get a friend to get the PDF from online, chapter PDF online for you, or, I don't know, buy it secondhand further down the line. I'm not sure exactly. But yeah, I felt I should mark it. Anyway, that is the end of the TrChFic news. So I'm going to end this rather lengthy intro section here, and we can continue with the show, and you'll hear my chat with Nicola Clayton and Sarah Lam. So I'll shut up now. So on the show, we have Sarah Lam and Nicola Clayton. Really exciting to have you both here. We're here to talk about not a conventional book, but an audiobook. So in relation to that book, and just in relation to yourselves, can you tell me a little bit about who you are and what you do? And let's just arbitrarily start with Sarah, if that's all right.
Yeah. Hi, my name is Sarah Lam, and I am an actor. Short but sweet.
There you go. Short but sweet. Uh-huh. And that will make more sense. I've said it's an audiobook, so I suppose that clears up who you are in relation to the book. Nicola, what about yourself? Are you an actor?
No, I'm not. My name's Nicola Clayton. I am an audiobook producer and director. And essentially what that means is that when Sarah narrates the book, I sit in the recording booth and listen to her and support her and enable her in any way that needs to happen or not as we go through. So I'm the listening buddy for the recording, basically. That's my job. And in terms of other background, I guess, what might be relevant as well is to say that in the early 80s, I studied modern Chinese studies at Leeds. So I have a bit of a connection to China way back when.
Right. And the Leeds Chinese department is, if any Chinese department in the world is a friend of the podcast, it's that one, because I've been to a couple of their events. They're just wonderful. I guess that's all I really needed to know about each of you. The listeners might want to know more, but I guess they'll find out as we go along. So there is another presence here in the show with us, not in body, but it's the author of the audiobook that you guys have helped bring into existence. He's Xuěmò. So we should introduce him. Would either of you, maybe looking more to Nicola here,
yes,
like to tell us a little bit more about Xuěmò?
Yeah, sure. So he was born in Gansu province in 1963 in a remote village called Liangzhou, which is now known as Wuwei. Forgive my tones, which are never that good. His birth name, or his non-writing name, is Chen Kai Hong. And he took the pen name when he became a writer, Shui and Mo, meaning snow and desert. And his idea was that he would bring a cooling sort of compassion to the desert, to the sort of stresses and the dryness and the cruelty of the desert. So that's where I believe that his pen name has come from. His family were desert farmers. So they lived in a rural village in the Hexi corridor, which I think is towards the north of Gansu province. It's on the Silk Road. There wasn't a lot of money. There weren't many books. So most of his early story experiences or stories that he heard were verbal storytelling. Very apt, seeing as our form is verbal storytelling too. And generally he would have visitors to the family home, and they would tell stories, and then he would remember them and then relate them back to his father, much to his parents' delight, basically his father's delight. So, and he also used to, after school, he would go to a neighbor, a blind neighbor who used to play, I think it's called the bandolor. It's a string instrument, and sing traditional Gansu stories. And so he sort of learnt his stories from verbal storytelling, from songs, and didn't really get access to a great deal of books until he was around the age of 15. He wrote an essay that won a competition, and that got him a place at a school, I think in the sort of local regional level. It was not his local school. He was able to go to a school that had lots of books. So suddenly he could read not just more Chinese books, but he could read Western books. He was particularly fond of Tolstoy. And that just opened his world. And he'd also had a very influential uncle who had persuaded him, encouraged him to apply perseverance. So he's quite a disciplined young lad, basically. He read a lot of books. He kept notes. He wrote a diary. And he did well at school. He didn't go to university, but he went on to become a high school teacher. And from quite a young age, he wanted to write, even though he didn't really have books around him. So he spent a lot of time writing. And then when he was in his mid-20s, he had a story published in Feitian magazine. And that brought him some fame and some public recognition, which, as I understand it, completely freaked him out. He got writer's block. He had terrible anxiety, and he just really got stuck. So he turned to Buddhism, the sort of local Buddhism that was the religion that was very popular around that area. Obviously, when you think of Gansu, you think of the Mogao Caves at Donghuan. So there was a history of Buddhism around there. And he turned to Buddhism and its practices and yoga and meditation with an aim to calm his anxiety, which worked. But it also brought him to those stories. And he finally managed to get his writing going by writing a classic story, Buddhist story, into a novel. And so he got back into writing through his Buddhism practices and was able and lost his writer's block and hasn't really had any since, by the sounds of things, because he's written about 80 pieces of work.
I would love to ask the question.
Yeah.
The name of the book that he wrote when he had writer's block.
Yes. Yes, of course. I do know the name of the book. It is...
Did you say it was a classic Buddhist tale that he...
Yes, it's called The Holy Monk and the Spirit Woman.
Can you repeat that, please?
Yes, The Holy Monk and the Spirit Woman.
Thank you.
A very mini summary of it. Sarah, it's a magical realist story inspired by the Tibetan Buddhist master Kyongpo Nagyur and his quest for enlightenment as he journeys across Tibet and Nepal in the 12th century.
Thank you.
And there's a translation by J.C. Cleary.
Okay. Perhaps I can be in touch with you directly about that.
Yes.
Yes, thank you.
Yes, do. So I was just about to say, Angus, the sort of stories that he wrote after he overcame his writer's block were based around Buddhism, but he then turned to stories that were based on his homeland, where he came from, the villages, the world that he grew up in. And this he turned into a trilogy called the Desert Trilogy. And it's made up of three books, Desert Rites, Desert Hunters, and White Tiger Pass. And they are all being translated by Howard Goldblatt and Sylvia Lee-Jung Lin. Have I said that right?
Sylvia Lin, yep.
Yeah.
I think that's his wife.
Yes, it is his wife, yes. So the first two have been translated and published. They're available on Amazon. I think it's Kindle, one definitely in print. And the third one, White Tiger Pass, is currently being translated. It took 20 years for him to write the trilogy. So he started in his mid-20s, and they were published when he was 46 in around 2000, and he became famous overnight in China. So suddenly, fortunately, this time he didn't get writer's block. You know, this time he had become accustomed to what he was, and obviously he was a much older man, you know, more seasoned with life. That trilogy is the one he's most famous for. The Holy Monk and the Spirit Woman actually became the third of a trilogy of that he calls the Soul Trilogy, and he wrote two other books, I believe, after that. It makes kind of, anyway. So I'm less familiar with those books. He has written in all sorts of forms. So he writes novels, but he also writes nonfiction. He writes basically self-help books or spiritual guidance books. So he's written a book about yoga. He's written an epic poem called Suo Sa Lang, I think that's what it's called. Forgive my tones, which are probably all off, but it's Suo Sa Lang. Sounds weird when I say it. Anyway, it looks much more normal when it's written down. And that is, that's an epic poem that's, I think, fairly recently finished. And he's also written a travelogue. He went to the US in, I think, 2019, and he wrote a travelogue about his experiences there, which he called A Contemporary Don Quixote in North America.
Oh, yes, that rings a bell.
He basically examines the US from an outsider's perspective. So this is the sort of background. He's famous as an author now in China. He's famous as someone who offers an alternative lifestyle. And he also, quite fascinatingly, is famous as a brand.
Mm.
His name has sort of become a brand as well as his sort of credibility. So from these small beginnings in a village where, you know, he had the odd comic book or the odd school book, but basically most of the storytelling that he was the recipient of was verbal or sung, he has ended up being a prolific writer. And always his stories are come out of his experience of being from Gansu and his Buddhism.
All right. That was a very comprehensive intro. Thank you very much, Nicola.
Was that too long?
No. Perfect. Okay. Perfect. Not too long, not too short.
It's but absolutely fascinating.
Yeah.
And I didn't know about Xuěmò when I started reading. Yeah. And I just, by coincidence, happened to be Buddhist too. And the bits that I wanted to pick out, I wanted to read a paragraph that particularly, you know, affected me on the reading. Not the actual me verbally reading, but me just reading the book. I've typed it out, and it's just so coincidental that the bit that I've typed out is so indicative of this man's life and his beliefs, and therefore chimes with mine. So thank you for giving us that wonderful introduction.
Oh, great. My pleasure. You know, I remember when I first read his biography, I thought it was a fantastic story in itself. His story is a fantastic story. I'm glad. It was wonderful to discover that you had that connection with Buddhism.
Did you say you wanted to read that part, Sarah?
Yes. I mean, at some point I can read it now, or I can read it later, you know.
Oh, no time like the present, I think.
Okay. All right. Okay. It was a question that I was thinking about, which part of the story had the most effect you know, on me as a reader. And it was very different reading the book as just enjoying it, as opposed to reading the book to prepare to read. And that's a very, very different hat that perhaps we might discuss later. And I just read this passage, and it meant so much to me that I thought, well, I'll type that out. And it is about, the book is about two sisters, or they were sisters-in-law, actually. There was a character called Lan Lan, I enjoyed Lan Lan's character very much. And there was another character, and the sister-in-law was called Ying, and I really felt for Lan Lan throughout the book, particularly when she talked about her marriage, which perhaps we'll come to later. But at one part in the book, Lan Lan is pretty close to dying. I mean, they were pretty close to dying throughout the book. But there was one very, very intense part when Lan Lan had become trapped in the sand. And she's just so full of courage. And she says, remember, whatever happens, don't be afraid. Fear kills. Once you start to be afraid, it gets worse. It creeps up on you, little by little. It's a seed that germinates and blossoms and sets seed again. Eventually, it becomes a smothering black cloud or a great flood that drowns you. You will lose the will to struggle on, and you just give up and let yourself die. You'll die because your mind died first. Once your mind dies, you're dead. So that was one of the phrases, one of the passages that Lan Lan said. And there was another one that I typed up, but I could actually be reading the whole book on this podcast, which is not desirable. But it's, you know, this very, very simple woman, through the writer, gives you these wonderful things that you can just take away with you and remember, you know. And it is said so simply, so it's not prolonged, and you don't get lost in what someone's trying to say. It's simple, short, powerful words. So anyway, that wasn't read as Lan Lan. That was just read.
No, that, well, I was thinking that. I thought this is being read as Sarah. That's, well, yes. If people want to hear it read as Lan Lan, they'll have to get the audiobook. Thanks.
Very well pitched.
But it, you know, it is. She creates these wonderful turning points, Lan Lan, and in the story, and as you say, when we hear a lot more from Ying than we do from Lan Lan. Lan Lan's action and Ying is thought. Mm-hmm. But when we hear thought from Lan Lan, it's very powerful.
Mm.
Just as when we get action from Ying, that's also very powerful, isn't it? There's a lovely counterbalance.
So they are a lovely counterbalance. And it was, I mean, the plot is actually very simple.
Mm.
You know, it's about two women on camelback, for want of a better expression, who go on a journey to seek out the salt pans. But that's just the physical journey. Really, I think this book is, to me, is about the inner journey, and their refusal, Lan Lan's refusal to give up hope. And when they actually faced the very real possibility of death, how they A, came to terms with it, and B, their attitude to living and dying. And towards the very, very end of the book, you saw by their actions and what they said what was important to them. Mm-hmm. And for Lan Lan, it was her spiritual journey that she'd come on, and her life and what she had fought to overcome. And she retained, I think, through her spirituality, she retained that essence of hope and courage and action. And for Ying,
yeah.
And for Ying, it was actually about the love for yeah. another human being. And I sort of, you know, I'm very fortunate to be to have a very, very loving marriage for decades. But when I read this story about Ying, I thought, oh, but Lan Lan is so wonderful. But then you realized, you know, that this woman, Ying, her power was so, so different. You know, when Lan Lan was really stark,
yeah,
it was Ying that took the action and saved her life, you know. Anyway, it's I digress. Please stop me.
Okay, yeah, I was just thinking I need to keep us moving as much as I'm enjoying hearing the back and forth. I was going to say, a nice thing about learning so much about Xuěmò is that he's information about him in English online is sort of scattered. It's a weird thing where he is really quite present on the Western internet in some ways, to the extent that I found he has a Pinterest, or at least someone's running a Pinterest for him. But on the other hand, most of what you can find is quite scattered, and his publication in English, I think, has been quite limited so far. But what I was going to say, to more to the point of everything you two have just been talking about, is I did not know that he had a reputation for being like very self-disciplined. I did know Buddhism was important for him, and I did know that he had a sort of a self-help angle to his writing and his brand as well. And I feel that all three of those things do sort of shine through in this story, which I realize we haven't named yet, so that'll be what I drive us to next. But yeah, the word that kept springing into my mind is, it's one of the words I keep shoehorning into this whole podcast almost every episode, is, well, it's an exaggeration, but many, many episodes, is existential. I've got a very strong existentialism radar, and yet the focus on life, death, and sort of willing, through your own willpower, creating your values, letting them see you through life, I felt that a lot in the book. And the self-help angle, I did feel through this story and many others in the book, the audiobook we're looking at, we do get very quotable paragraphs that wouldn't look too out of place in a possibly Buddhist-inflected, but not necessarily Buddhist-inflected, self-help book. Like, I was thinking that line, when your mind dies, you die, so yeah, never give up. That would make an awful lot of sense in a sort of an atheist perspective as well. Yeah. If you believe the material world is all we've got, all the more reason to, you know, make the most of it while you're here.
But Buddhism, in many forms of Buddhism, is an atheist religion.
Right.
You know, I mean, there were so many different Buddhisms, aren't there? But many of them are, you know, is an atheist religion compared with maybe Christianity. You know, so
yeah,
I'm surprised.
Yes. So the million-dollar question: what is this story called?
Oh yes, it's called The Women, the Camels, and the Dholes.
And we should make a distinction here. That's a story in the book.
Yes, we're discussing the novella, which is the fourth yeah. of four stories, which is in Selected Stories by Xuěmò. And it was translated by Nikki Harmon and is available in all formats, including audiobook.
Right, okay, so print, ebook, audiobook.
Yes, yeah.
Desert Scroll, maybe?
I don't know about the Desert Scroll. It might be a bit long for that.
True. You need a long scroll. How did this audiobook come about, if we can share that story at all?
Yeah, sure. I mean, it's actually quite a simple story. I met the publisher at the Frankfurt Book Fair in 2019. We kept in contact. And then last year, they got in touch and asked me whether I'd be prepared to, or I would like to produce the audiobook for them. Once we sort of figured out that that was possible and how we would do it, the next major thing was to cast. So, and then casting is really key for an audiobook. I don't know how much you listen to audiobooks, but it really makes a difference to the experience of the book. And with this book, three out of the four stories had female protagonists, and there's some quite sensitive subjects covered. Particularly relating to women's health and experiences. So we definitely wanted to go for a female narrator. And then we also wanted someone who, particularly at the beginning of this story, the women, the camels and the dolls, there is a narrator voice. So we wanted someone who brought, the maturity of the author and the life experience. So I knew about Sarah from Inspector Chen. Sarah plays Peichun in the BBC Radio 4 dramatisation of the Inspector Chen novels. I'm saying that right, aren't I? Is it Peichun? Yeah. So, that's how I knew Sarah's voice. I'd known Sarah from other things as well, but that's particularly how I sort of associated. And we were lucky enough. Sarah at the time was in one production and rehearsing for another, both theatre productions. And we managed to just fit in the little window that she had for a few days, across a few days in late August. So that's basically how the book came about. We recorded it in about 2.5 days, was it, Sarah? Or was it 2 days? It was over 3 days, I think.
It was over three days.
Yeah. And then edited, proofed, delivered within 2 weeks sort of thing. So fairly straightforward audiobook production process.
All right. I'm going to follow up my $1 million question with a $2 million question.
Okay.
so the story is called The Woman, the Camels, and the Dholes. We've established that. We've established that the woman, Lan Lan and Ying, are crossing the desert. That would explain what the camels are for.
Yes.
But what on earth are dholes?
Oh, that's a very good question. Now, I'd never heard of dholes before. They are wild dogs that have a particularly vicious way of attacking their prey, which is explained at the beginning of the story. And I don't know how much you would want me to go into here, or whether we should. Are you wanting that detail?
We could talk a little bit about what the dholes are doing in the story without spelling out where they do or don't make their exit, what they do or don't do.
Okay. So the dholes, as we discover in an introduction, have a way of attacking their prey, which is really rather nasty. So if you're of a sensitive nature, close your ears for the next sort of 15 seconds. But essentially what they do is they attack the stomach of their victim. They sink their teeth in, they rip the intestines out, and then they run away. So they basically disembowel people, which is, or animals, hopefully animals, not people. But obviously we have this situation early on in the story where the girls have, they're not girls, the young women, actually they're not so young, the women have realized that they're being stalked by a pack of dholes, of these wild dogs, and are fearful for their lives. So it has, this encounter has a knock-on effect that affects the whole of the rest of their journey.
Right. I actually realized we should probably turn to the camels briefly as well, because
yes,
although I think probably a lot of our listeners wouldn't be surprised to learn that there are a lot of camels inside China, we might have some who would be. I certainly can say that when I went off to go live and work in China as a TEFL teacher, I didn't expect to see a camel occasionally in the little town I was in, way away in Zhejiang province in the east. But sure enough, there was a camel. And if you know a bit about the geography of China, it's not really so strange. So just to bulk this question out a bit, why are the women riding on camels? Like, apart to get from the salt pans, what are the camels to them?
Okay. Well, they're the most, their standard method of transport, basically. They don't have bicycles. You wouldn't cross a desert on a bicycle, really, because you don't have roads. So camels are able to deal with the terrain that the girls are, that the women, I don't know why I keep calling them girls, that the women are crossing. And they also are real characters, you know. So, mm-hmm. Yeah.
Can I just
yes,
in there to say that, in fact, you know, the title really does, it does give fair credit to not only the dolls, but the camel as well. And again, you know, towards the end of the book, when the camel is really struggling and suffering, it really got to me, you know. And the camel, the writer gives this camel his, not only it is a male camel, and Xuěmò gives this male camel a very male identity. And the camel at one point, actually, one of the camels actually wanders off. And there is this whole there's a whole psychology about why the camel would do that. And he talks about the camel's feelings. And he says something like this. He said, you could have hazarded a guess that it had come back because in fact the camel does come back, because it couldn't bear to abandon two women in the desert or something like that. But it must have had a desperate struggle with its conscience to make that decision, as desperate as a battle with the dholes. And when the camel is really, really struggling, the women offer him some fluid, some liquid, and you actually get inside the psyche of the camel when he says, the camel never imagined that this lovely woman would give it oil to drink. She must be teasing. The camel was truly moved. Now, how wonderful to write about a camel like that. I mean, I will never think about camels in the same way, you know, because they were such a part of the book. So I just thought that I would, with that, Nicola.
You know? Yeah, no, absolutely. And I think what I love about the writing, and obviously the translation as well, which is you don't always think about, but it's beautifully translated, is that the author changes the point of view throughout the story. Mm-hmm. So sometimes we're with Lan, sometimes we're with Ying, and then sometimes we've got the author's voice. But at one point, the point that Sarah's talking about, we actually go into camel perspective, which is just fabulous. You know, we hear the camel's thoughts and voices. So in a way, that's the most wonderful compassion for his characters that comes through the writing. So the camels are so central to the story. And you're right, I hadn't thought about it, Sarah, but they bring a male perspective and a male energy to the story that would be missing otherwise, that's only reflected through the women's thoughts. They actually have this part in the story. Yeah,
right. Oh gosh, I had a question in my head
and we've just taken you right off.
It's just evaporated. give me a little second. Nope, it's not coming. I don't think it was important anyway.
Was it about camels or was it about the—
I really don't know. Oh, I've remembered. So you mentioned the quality of the translation, and okay, it's not surprising to hear that it's a great translation, because it's from Nikki Harmon, friend of the show, in fact. I think a two-time guest on the show, possibly three times, but certainly sort of one of the totems of the podcast. I've done a lot of her translations. So I just wanted to ask, did either of you have any contact with her at all, or indeed any contact with Xuěmò, or were they both sort of distant figures at the other side of the desert in this project?
So with Nikki, I know her from Chinese literature events. I didn't discuss the book with her, actually. No. In terms of Xuěmò, I was in contact with someone at his publisher. So when I have, okay, there were questions, there were the odd question that I had about the text. So then I did ask, you know, I checked certain bits of information. There was one bit of the translation that is, okay, so we've talked about being in Lan's perspective, and we talk about being in Ying's and the camels and the authors. At one very, very small point, we also go into the perspective of some bullets, as in gun bullets.
Right.
Okay, and I just had to check that translation because it was such a strange sentence. But actually, it was totally accurate. I mean, I had the Chinese, so I did go back and look, and then I did check, and it's like, no, okay. So there were one or two things where I did check, and I sort of checked a couple of pronunciations as well.
All right, okay.
Funnily enough, that was one of the
quotes you've got.
Yeah, one of the other quotes I've actually got here, not just from the camels, but from the perspective of the bullets.
Well, read the bullets line, because it's extraordinary.
Yeah. Okay, so
listeners, Nicola's pointing at the screen.
I'm sorry, I'm directing Sarah.
It's okay. Okay, so it says, so it's written, there was a burst of gunfire. The cluster of pellets whistled on their way, zooming towards their target like honeybees to blossom, like hungry houseflies homing on foul blood, like a rather stallion leaping out of its corral, like ejaculated sperm surging towards the welcoming womb, like tadpoles joyfully freed from the entrapping mud into fresh water. Is that paragraph?
Yes, it was. There was a little bit just after that where they, as they're shooting across, they seem to turn their eyes back and wiggle their tails.
Right.
Do you remember that? To sort of say, hey, we're on the way for you there, ladies, sort of thing.
But what a coincidence that we have...
both found that. I mean, and I think that's also a wonderfully captures the descriptive elements of Xuemo's writing, because there is so much richness in the description that it brings character and colour to so many things. And this also is wonderful when you're working with an audiobook, because Sarah can then bring that even more to life. She's, you know, the palette is there. You know, what a narrator does is a narrator paints with words. You know, they take the words off the page and they create a rainbow colour of characters and atmospheres and pacing that isn't necessarily in the reader's ear if they read it off the page.
The other thing I think, when I was thinking about this book, is that as an actor, you play, normally play maybe one or two parts in a play. I have played multi roles. My last play, I played, I think, four or five parts, all with different accents. But quite apart from that, normally you would play one character in a play, and you are the protector of that character. Your whole job as an actor is to deliver that character. So you only really see the play from that character's viewpoint. Whereas when you are narrating, you are, you know, you represent all those characters, and you have to bring all those characters to life, whether they're the camel or whether they're, you know, Lan-Lan, or indeed the writer's voice themselves. So that's quite a different job that a narrator has from the actor's job when they're performing in theatre or even radio.
It is a very different craft. You know, it's a different kind of skill, and it's a very different skill base, and also obviously listening experience, you know, reading experience. Right.
Totally.
I can see you want to move us on, Angus.
I just wanted to make a little comment of my own. This is on my mind because in the last episode I was talking to Jenna, or sorry, two episodes ago, I was talking to Jenna Tang about lots of things, but one of the things we briefly touched on was we were talking about a piece of Taiwanese literature, and we were wondering, is there anything that could kind of characterize Taiwanese literature as a whole? Because obviously it's a messy business trying to ascribe national characteristics to any kind of literature. And I think that's even more so for literature coming from China, which is such a huge and often, what's the adjective? I don't know what the adverb I'm looking for is, but the adjective I want is diverse, such a diverse literary world. But something I've heard people comment on, and something I think is true for Xuemo's generation of writers in stuff I've read in translation, is everything is very embodied, or the body is very, very foregrounded and important. Flesh isn't something you can escape from. There's a lot of descriptions of sometimes scatological stuff, or just it's got that sort of very material biological thing going on. And I think it's maybe telling that Xuemo, even when we're in the desert, he makes everything alive. There's a very alive sort of feeling to all sorts of things, whether it's the plants, whether it's the sand, the sun, old man sun as he's called, the camels, even bullets are embodied with some kind of a mind or a spirit. And it's on one hand, it does remind me of some other writers of a similar age who I've read. On the other hand, it's very peculiar and unique to, I guess, himself, or to this collection of stories in this book. Because, there were bits when I was listening to the audiobook where I did the same double take I think you might have done there, Nicola. I was like, but what did he just describe? But, you know, that's his style. I did have a question about his style, but you were both there talking about what makes the audiobook medium special, so I thought we could jump. Don't know if we're necessarily jumping forward, because we might jump backwards again. So if we can hopscotch to that question.
Yeah.
What audiobooks in general, is there a lot to sort of unpack and analyze about that medium? And what it can do.
Well, I was thinking about this. There are several things that it does. I mean, the first thing is that oral storytelling is the oldest form of storytelling that us humans have. You know, we sitting around a campfire, these days it's a bedtime story, it's sitting in the pub telling your friends, it's sitting over dinner. Oral storytelling is our oldest tradition. And what audiobooks does is it it brings that into the reading process. So it's a very intimate form of storytelling. It's someone in your ear. Often people wear headphones when they listen to audiobooks. I tend to not. I usually listen to them when I'm driving or cooking or, you know, doing things around the house. But it's still very intimate. It's one-on-one. So there's sort of an element of that. And then you have this, for me, it's the purest form of storytelling that's not on paper, because you just have the narrator and the story and the listener. And that's it. There's no sound design. There's no camera position. There's no editorial input. The only input that you might get is if I suggest maybe a character might be a different way. And then, you know, that's really as much, but most of the creativity comes out of the narrator's mind and their skill and their talent. And as I said before, a narrator can bring something out of the text because they live through those characters that as a reader you might not see on the page. I can guarantee you virtually every single audiobook that I've produced or directed, the narrators have always pulled things out that I didn't see when I was prepping it. And I read all the books before, you know, we always make discoveries. We often find as we're recording, when we have our breaks, we sit and we discuss aspects of the story because they're so striking. And when you read something out loud, you do make discoveries that you don't discover on the page in the same kind of way. I think you really do. You're nodding there. You agree, Sarah?
Absolutely. I mean, and it works both ways. I mean, you know, it was lovely to read the book. Just to read it for myself, and I got a lot out of it. But when you read a book, the simplest way to describe it is you live it. You absolutely live it, and your heart is in their heart. And there are times when you come out at the end of 3 days, and it's felt like a whole lifetime, you know, and you sort of get in the car and you drive away, and you're just a little bit, you know, you're just a completely... take because your whole mind, and you've also been prepping the book. It takes me, my last book took me four, most of the time my books take at least 40 hours of prep because I can't do it any quicker. It's as simple as that. So you have to love what you read, so, which I've done, you know. You just go on this journey, and it's what I've always described for an actor who narrates. It's instant gratification, because when you've done that work and you put your heart and soul into it, you that's it. It's there. It's there, and it's got your name attached to it. So you put in 110%, and it just your whole mind just takes over, you know, and it just comes out, and you sometimes you are surprised at how a character comes out on the day, you know, particularly perhaps a character you've struggled with, and then you're in the middle of the story and it just comes out of your mouth, which is a great relief sometimes.
But it is an extraordinary process. It is for the narrator, it is physically grueling. You know, I always say, particularly to new narrators, do not arrange to do anything in the evening. Do not go out. Do not expect to speak to anyone, because when you record, a narrator is reading for 6 hours in the day. And, you know, if you think of doing another job for 6 hours in the day, you know, you think, well, you know, 6 hours is a short day. But actually, when you think that you're physically creating these characters, the mind is working, it is an amazing craft. Not everyone can do it. Not every actor can do it. You know, it's but prep is so vital. There's one other thing. Well, there are two other things that happen with audiobooks. One, obviously, is you can read more books if you listen to audiobooks, because you can read books when you're not able to sit down and read a book. You know, so as I said, I listen to an audiobook when I'm driving, when I'm cooking. You know, I don't tend to sit down and just listen to an audiobook. So I listen to different kinds of books when I do that. Some people do it when they're running or whatever. And the other thing about what audiobooks can bring to translated fiction is they can help readers who find they have barriers with translated fiction. So it can be that the names are a little bit scary. So, you know, you don't know how the names are pronounced. You see these words, they're not familiar. And that can put some people off and they're not quite sure who's who. If the names are sort of the Chinese names, because they can be quite short and we know there aren't a lot of sounds in Chinese and they're not very familiar to people who aren't familiar with Chinese. So that can be tricky. And what you can have, two things happen with an audiobook. One is the lovely narrator pronounces all the names correctly for you. So you don't have to worry about how they're pronounced. You know, there's no sort of making something up. I don't know how that is, but in my head, I'm reading it like this sort of thing. The narrator takes all that away and all of that sort of extra work is just gone. And the second thing is that a narrator creates the characters. So you can hear who's who, even if you can't remember the names, you can hear who's who. I'll give you an example, which is not a Chinese fiction, but I directed Crime and Punishment. And the Russian names are quite a challenge. And some of the characters have three different names. There's a nickname, there's a full name, there's a, you know, there's a, so they've got all these different names. And the narrator I work with, we used, they don't have regional accents in the same way that we do in the UK, but we use British regional accents to identify characters. So, you know, for some, it's very interesting reading the sort of reviews on Audible. Some people go, it's a bit weird having those sort of British regional accents, but a lot of people said, I knew who was who, because you knew that the Welsh guy was the detective. And you knew that, you know, the narrator did use different voices as well as accents. So there was one particular chap who was someone's father who was from Yorkshire sort of thing. So this brings something completely fresh to translated fiction, and it can open up the sort of translated fiction to people who might not necessarily listen to it because they might have some barriers. So.
Yeah, you've reminded me of the film The Death of Stalin. Did either of you happen to see that?
No.
Well, there's a guy who comes in and sort of... the whole film is sort of a what's the thick of it style comedy, just sort of awful political wrangling. And then there's this war hero general who defeated the Nazis in X number of battles shows up. He's played by Jason Isaacs. And he talks like this. Right then, enough of that. And it's just perfect. I guess my feeling about swapping out regional accents, so like I say like copying and pasting a Scottish accent onto Dongbei in the northeast of China, Manchuria, for like some rough northerners, that could be done really badly or it could be done really well, and it's always, but it's in either case it's an interesting intellectual game.
I had a couple of years ago I was looking into this about how I might do audiobook regional accents in China using British accents, and I
risky business.
Had a lot of fun looking at that, and I think I took Scotland actually into the west. I took it because I thought that, you know, there was a sort of a nice variety there. I'm trying to remember what we did. I think we thought Welsh for Manchuria, which is kind of interesting because the Tudors came from Wales. So,
right. Yes. I suppose now that I think of it, I'm skeptical about that sort of approach, but I'm mostly thinking in terms of the page. I think accents often do not look good on the page.
Oh, no, they don't. You don't want them written on. You just want the actor to be able to bring them in. And I kind of get what you're saying in terms of it's skeptical. But the simple answer is if you have a lot of characters in a book, in an audio book, you have to do something to help the listener because you can't assume that, you know, everyone being RP, you just can't, when you've got the variants of emotions going on, you can't always get them to land exactly. You know, some characters will overlap in terms of what they sound like. So, you're not looking sure about that, Sarah?
No, I'm just listening.
I have a couple of technical questions. In fact, it's basically the same technical question, but for each of you, because I think you'll each have very different answers. Sarah, I thought I'd ask you first. And it's just this. Did working on this book in particular present any challenges for you that were particular to it?
Good question. When Nicola first approached me, I was a little worried because I'm not a Mandarin speaker. And I mean, quite by chance during lockdown, I did study the pronunciation, the pinyin pronunciation.
Oh, excellent.
And that was just by chance, which really, and that involved obviously quite a lot of tonal practice as well. So it wasn't completely impossible for me. And then Nicola and I work quite closely together, you know, and it's in prep time for it. And then she listened very carefully to every single time I spoke a character's name. But I was a little concerned, but then I sort of realized that the book, I had to sort of think this through, that the book had been translated into English and that my job was to read the English and to tell the story, you know, in the same way that you would any other translated story, which is interesting because we've just been talking about that. The few things that I felt, and I wouldn't necessarily describe them as challenges, but they were just things that I was very aware of as a narrator, and that was the sheer stamina that it took, because the story is not plot driven. You know, the story is very simple. It doesn't have huge twists and turns. And it's that steady build-up of pressure, you know, on these women, and it was going on that journey of survival of over 150 pages, on a life-changing journey. That in itself has its own pressure on the narrator. I love the fact that the narrator, the author had a very strong voice. You know, you really could hear the author speaking. So what that does for a narrator is that they are so involved in being these women, and then you would have a paragraph where where you step out and you take, as it were, the writer's point of view. And you can hear the writer. And what that does do is it takes you away from the mindset of the character that you are narrating, or the character that you are in that moment. So I wouldn't really say that they were challenges. I think the actual, yes, probably the stamina was a challenge to keep that going, you know, right until, you know, the very end of the story. But it was really a very, very intense and emotional experience. You know, I loved it. So those are my challenges.
Great. I'm just going to flag up. We've gone past 7. Are you okay to keep going for a bit?
Just a little bit longer, and then I need to wave you goodbye.
Okay.
No problem at all.
Did you want me to answer the same question?
Yeah, I was just going to cap that by saying, totally appropriate that it was the challenge was endurance, because that's the sort of story we're dealing with. So I'm not surprised at all there. Nicola, what about yourself? What were the sort of hurdles you had to figure out for this project?
Well, they're pretty close to Sarah's, actually. So effectively, it was how we deliver the Chinese words in an English language. So I've always... there are sort of two aspects with Chinese. There's like making the right sounds, and then there's making the right tones. And, you know, it's pretty straightforward to make the right sounds with the sort of, I sort of know enough of the words, I know how to pronounce something that's in pinyin. But I did go back to the original and looked up, and we checked the tones, basically. So, and delivered a vocabulary list which had the right tones. But the biggest challenge is really a bizarre thing, but because in Chinese tones, obviously it's a form of stress, isn't it? You know, if it's a fourth tone, then the sound drops down. But in English, you can hear from the way I'm speaking, we use stress all the time. So how do you, you know, or how does Sarah talk about one of the characters and use their name in a way that naturally in English, the stress would go down, but the character tone goes up? That is, for me, the sort of technically most challenging aspect of the audiobook, because Sarah is naturally narrating. And then I'm saying to her, oh, but that character's name is supposed, the tone is supposed to go up, not down. And that's where, to me, that was the greatest challenge for Sarah, not for me, because she's wanting to deliver the right emotion, you know, and the stress and all of that. But at the same time, she's got me coming on the mic going, well, I'm not supposed to go up, not down, you know. So I think for me, that was the biggest challenge. And we found a way around it. You know, how do you make the name go up, but the stress land as well? So, but I think it brings this wonderful aspect actually to Sarah's reading of the book, because it's got this lyrical quality, it's got these rhythms, it's got repetition, sense of repetition sometimes. You know, you can see Xuěmò's influence from his Huara songs and things from his childhood, and actually finding a way around this challenge just, I think, contributed to that delivery in the end. That's the way I viewed it.
People who listen to other China related podcasts might have stumbled across the Chinese History podcast that's hosted by an American guy called Laszlo Montgomery. It's actually the first China related podcast I ever listened to. When I knew I was going to be working there, should have brushed up on my language, but I went for the easy stuff that interested me. So I started listening to this history podcast, and I started wondering, why is he pronouncing some things so bizarrely? And then I realized a little further down the line, it's the names, people's names and places that he's pronouncing using odd inflections. And it didn't take me too much longer to figure out it's because he's taking extra care to pronounce the tones, because sure enough, he's a very fluent and diligent speaker. So if listeners are wondering what Nicola and Sarah are kind of describing, if you listen to an episode of his show and then listen to this audiobook, you'll get the same sort of thing. Although, of course, Sarah, you're doing something very special there in sort of uniting it with the flow of the story. And I can attest to someone who's listened to it. Yeah, it's impressive and it's unique. I've not heard anything like it, and I'm not just saying that.
Wow.
Marvelous.
Thank you so much. Actually, that is absolutely down to Nicola. My job was to tell that story. And because I knew that Nicola was listening to every single time I opened my mouth to say a Chinese word, I could just go with it, because I knew if there was something that was not quite right, she would pick it up, you know. And that was the support that you need.
Yes. You know?
So it was, I'm glad we pulled it off, Nicola.
So am I.
And on that note, it's been an absolute pleasure talking to both of you. Thank you so much.
Likewise, Sarah, thank you very much for coming on the show. I think you are our very first voice actor, or any kind of actor who's come on the show. So, yeah, it was even better than I thought it would be. Marvelous. And thank you for doing those readings as well. Those were great.
Thank you. Thank you very, very much. It's been an absolute pleasure.
Likewise.
Sorry to see you. Bye.
Yeah, so there was a few questions we hopscotched over. Okay. We're going to hopscotch back to them. The one I really want to ask is about metaphors and messages, because although it's a really simple story, you do feel at points that Xuěmò is asking you to think. Maybe not necessarily to analyze it on any deep critical level, but it does seem like there are messages and that there are symbols. So what would you say about that, deeper meanings in the story?
Yes, there are. I mean, I guess, first of all, what I would say is it's a survival story. So it is a story that gives you all sorts of ideas about what it takes to survive in this world, both physically in the desert and metaphysically. Can I say that? And basically what it takes to get your mind through a period of intense stress. So I think that comes out of it. What happens is facing death seems to bring out the women's characteristics more strongly. I don't know if I'm going to be able to give you anything particularly good on this, to be honest.
It's all right. Simple things are often the most profound.
Well, kind of what I was thinking was, what you find, the two characters are split. Ying tends to be quite philosophical, and she is the one who's thinking about her life, their situation, what it means, the environment that she's in. Lan Lan is the action person. But as we said earlier, at certain points, they flip. So what comes out as the overall message from these two characters is that, first of all, the importance of connection and collaboration, you know, the importance of being, of tolerating and being with people. That's sort of one of the things that I take out of it. The value of loyalty. And, you know, they stick loyally to one another. They don't give up on one another. Whenever one faces the point where they think they're going to give up, the other one pulls them through. So there's an aspect of that. Also, something really interesting happens is that they each instinctively react to their situation. And that instinct drives them to do something that ends up with quite a surprising outcome that isn't what they originally intended. So, for example, when Ying basically has given up and thinks she's going to dig her own grave, she ends up producing a route out for them, although it's sort of with some danger involved. And likewise, when we don't see it, but Lan Lan relates to the fact that when she goes off to try and find a route out of the desert for them, she drops to her knees and prays. And when she's on her knees, she discovers another thing that actually, you know, helps them get through their journey. So I think there is definitely a message of the mind and the instinct can find solutions that are not what you think you're looking for, but that actually help you in the way that you most need it. So whether that be divine intervention or just a human instinct that takes you sort of in a certain direction. So I think that's very present in the story.
Hmm. I can actually bounce back on that, because I did find it kind of hard to think on any deeper level about the story, because it is, in one way, so much just pure survival. But I figured all the existential stuff, it's impossible to ignore. And at least the way whenever I think about these sort of questions about survival, striving, it leads me to think about what is the world? Is it a place that is good place? Is it a good place to be that nourishes you and is full of joys that make life worth living? Is it a place where you're constantly being dragged down? You constantly have to find food to survive. You're always losing energy unless you're eating. Your life is always ticking down. Your little health bar is never going up in that sense. There are a million ways you can hurt yourself, strain yourself. It's far easier for things to go wrong than go right. The force of gravity is always dragging you down. So is it an actively nasty place, or is the world just neutral and indifferent? And is that scarier, that because there is no meaning except meaning you inscribe yourself? So there's that angle. And I think when the characters are constantly deciding whether or not to keep on going, that's where my mind went. But then what you said there about, it was not something I picked up on, that one character is thoughtful and reflective and lives in her mind, and the other is proactive and not so reflective. And it strikes, maybe I'm projecting here, but when we were talking about Xuěmò early in this episode, we were saying, on one hand, he's very much of the mind. He's into Buddhism. He's into spirituality. He likes to write. Writers tend to be of the mind, not usually great athletes, maybe with some exceptions. But he's also into self-help, and he's extremely disciplined. So he's obviously got a handle on action as well. And I'm just spitballing here, but I think if you are a typical writer or intellectual type person, it's very hard for you to naturally be proactive. You have to sort of think yourself into being like that, or cultivate the habit. So when I think of these two characters who kind of learn to be a little bit like each other, reach spiritual epiphanies, but also pull themselves out the dirt, to me it kind of seems like it's a synthesis and it's an synthesis and antithesis producing a synthesis. It's two opposites merging to produce something that is more than the sum of the parts. So that's about as deep as I can get.
But that's interesting for two aspects, actually. One is, in a biography that Xuěmò sent to me, which is written from the first person, he says that this particular story captures the conflict he has between being spiritual and of the mind and being practical.
Right.
So what you've described is actually that he's made up of those two. And I think if you grow up in an environment that he grew up in, where you're on the desert's door, where survival is such a struggle, throughout the story, there are so many practical bits of information about how to survive in the desert. So that knowledge is sort of there. And let me see if I can get the second idea back, because it's gone. Second idea.
Is it about the nature of the world?
No, it was about, I think it's gone.
It's okay. Sometimes these things reappear, sometimes they don't. Only time will tell. You can travel 1,000 miles in your head. You can justify anything. If you're dying in the desert, you can use intellectual lines of reasoning or spirituality to tell yourself it's fine to just lie down and die, that's actually a good thing. Or you could, in your head, decide that actually life's worth living and you should get up and strive. But actually, you can't do that without taking action. Thought's a luxury, or it's a huge time waster. But it's, yeah, when you're in conditions, you're forced to confront that, I think.
But it's very interesting, and I think the characters are, in this very brutal environment, they're pushed to being very emotionally honest. So Lan, the one time we get this massive confession that she talks to Ying about her marriage, which I think Sarah referred to earlier. You know, for me, that's the part of the story that hits me the most, is when Lan describes her marriage and her relationship with her husband. And that is, she just feels that she only has a very small amount of time left in her life, and she has to tell this sister-in-law of hers the truth about the experience so that everything's put into a context. So I think that's a really interesting, I mean, you know, it's an observation, is just the fact that when you are in an extreme circumstance, the desire to be truthful and to get your story down is very powerful. So, yeah.
Not to make... take us down too morbid a road here, but I remember as like an undergrad or a high schooler often hearing people sort of reason that the fact that we're mortal, that our lives are limited, isn't such a bad thing, because without time, a time constraint, or death, to use the word, nothing would have meaning. It's a kind of a strange gift in a way, in that it makes everything meaningful. And I kind of understood that on an intellectual level as a younger man. But now I'm 28, so I feel like I'm past my physical peak, and I'm more, maybe more importantly, just in practical terms, the time came a couple years ago to get a move on if I wanted to do things like own a house or get a decent salary later in my life. Certainly not there yet. But yeah, that time constraint was horribly stressful for quite a few years once I became aware that the time constraint existed. But it has pushed me to get myself together, and it did lead to getting out of the desert. Without oversharing, but yeah, it's not as dire a situation as being trapped under sand or hunted by dholes, but once you face these things, it produces some honesty that could produce salvation further down the line.
It's absolutely true. I mean, you know, it may be a bit of a cliche, but we get a pearl from sand being... from friction, from sand, isn't it? Friction creates a pearl. And the simple fact is that, and I guess actually this is also very much a Buddhist concept, is that we are structured and designed and constantly evolving as a result of the friction that we experience in our life. You can't get away from friction, and friction actually develops and matures you, basically, for want of a better word. So, and whilst we think that we might like to have an easy time of it, we benefit so much from these experiences, and we develop and we grow, so that it becomes, it would be lovely to have the physical sort of prowess and health and strength that one has in one mid-20s. But there are so many other things that you would trade for that. You know, there are... once you get a certain amount of life under your belt, once you've dealt with these challenges that these women face, they face them in their life, but then they're facing very different challenges in the desert, puts everything into perspective. And it is a strangely rewarding process. You wouldn't think it would be, but it is.
It's really funny you mention pressure, because I'm going to do Xuěmò proud here. I'm going to take us even more down the self-help road. I attended a three-hour workshop that my job hosted on mental health. And the most, this maybe tells you something about me, my favorite part of it was where the woman running it asked us, what's the difference between pressure and stress? And first reaction, they mean the same thing. But actually, if you sort of stop and think, the conclusion me and the people I was in the group with arrived at is that stress is an internal thing which is produced by pressure, which is forced from the outside, generally speaking. You could pressure yourself, but ultimately you're probably pressuring yourself because of something external. It could be social expectations, or it could just be time, which is that's the constant pressure. But yeah, it's an interesting thing to think, because stress, it's hard to really say if stress does anything useful except tell you you're in a situation you should get out of, a bit like pain. Whereas pressure, if you can avoid converting it into stress, which is like the acid in your body, just like lactic acid in your muscles. Yeah, what you said about the pearl is the perfect metaphor. Pressure can shape you, and when things are shaped, they can be squashed, but they can also be turned into amazing sculptures.
Yes. And it is a little bit semantics, but I totally hear what you're saying there. And actually, even physiologically, when you talk about the stress systems within the body and pressure, pressure can be very beneficial. And even stress can be beneficial afterwards, as long as you break it. It stops. Constant pressure, stress is not good. But we are designed to deal with stress and pressure. Mm. And just it's actually knowing that but not constantly, because our body systems don't work well. And with these women, they do, going back to the story, they are dealing with both things, you know. But actually you get a sense from the story that the greatest stress that they've experienced is back at home in the village. They both had, you know, these very challenging personal experiences back in the village, as we discover on the journey. So actually, I think that's very interesting you bring that up, because this is a very pressurized situation and environment that they're in. But how they deal with it is particularly interesting, because it's rare that they let the stress really get to them. They have moments, but then they pull one another out of it, or something happens.
I've not been in very many like situations where how I acted was really high stakes, be it a social situation or like physical danger. But the times that I have, it's true. Something kicks in and the stress is all kicked down the road for later. And the adrenaline, I guess, kicks in instead. I guess we could talk more and more about this. I'm tempted to make it even more biological, but I think I can... speed us to the miscellaneous section.
Should be moving
on. got to get through the desert.
Yes.
To get to the salt pans. So my next thing was a regular feature on the show, the musical pairing. If you could set this story to a piece of music, or if you could pair a piece of music with it, what would it be? Now, I have one picked out here.
Yes.
Do you have one yourself?
I don't. I don't reference things in that way, but I do reference things through film. So this story actually reminds me of two films really kept coming to mind that deal thematically with this. And so would I talk about those now? Would we talk about
it? Go for it, yes. No time like the present. Okay. Tell us what your films are.
So the two films that actually I realized when I looked into them, they both came out the same year in 2013. I don't know why that is.
One is
Tracks, which is an Australian film. It stars Mia Wasikowska. I think that's how you pronounce her name. It is the story of, based on a woman's memoir, a lady called Robin Davidson. And she took a journey with four camels and her pet dog across the Australian outback.
Oh, I remember trailers for that.
Yeah.
You've stirred a very deep memory.
It's a stunning film. It's a quite a quiet film. She does have human interaction. There is a Adam Driver plays, and I think a New York Times, an American journalist photographer who takes pictures of her at different points on her route. And she does meet Aborigines at one point. And, you know, so she meets certain people who help her on her journey. But that's the one film. And that's a very interesting film because she's on a spiritual quest, basically. She's trying to find herself, but it turns into a survival journey. So, and the second film is called All Is Lost. It stars Robert Redford.
Oh, yes, I've heard of this one.
And it is a man on a boat in the ocean and the boat starts to leak. And it is one man and that boat for an hour and a half. And it is an absolute survival story. So all the little things he does to try and repair the boat and how he deals with the situation. But it turns into something more spiritual because it is so... it becomes transcendent. And those two stories always go through my mind. I listened to the audiobook again before we recorded, and it is such a visceral, visual book, the story, this, the women, the camels and the dolls. And it seems very cinematic to me. You know, I could totally see the story as a film. I sort of don't know why it isn't a film. It'd be a great first feature for someone because it's very, you know, it's a tricky environment, but just two actors and the camels. And so to me, now there's probably music in those two films that actually might be appropriate for this, but actually it's thematically and in terms of structure, those two films really do have essences that relate to the story.
Does All Is Lost have dialogue, or does Robert?
No, it's amazing. There are, I think it's less than 50 words. There's pretty much no dialogue. It is, right. It is such a gripping film. I saw it in the cinema. The cinema was fairly full. There was a chap down the same row as me who nearly jumped out of his seat at one point. And at the end of the film, he couldn't get out of his chair. He just had to sit there for about 5 or 10 minutes. To recover himself. It's grueling, but absolutely fascinating and totally engaging, because you're watching all the small practical things that he does to survive, and you keep thinking all is lost, that's the title, and then he finds a way to sort of move forward. So that sort of pattern is very similar to our story.
Wonderful. I have a much less profound choice. I've picked a song called Alive by Sa Ding Ding, and I don't know how to pronounce all the characters. It's a three-character Chinese title. I could see characters 2 and 3 were Wu and Sheng. The first character is Wan. So Wan Wu Sheng literally translates, according to Google Translate, as All Things Are Born, which is a wonderful title, much better than just Alive. Not because it's an existential survival grind, not really because it evocates the desert, but because I guess well, I haven't checked this actually, but I assume Sa Ding Ding, judging by that name, is a Han Chinese songwriter. But in this album that this song comes from, you can hear she's taking influences from around the sort of south and west of China. There's a version of this song which is, it doesn't even say what language it's in, but it has, I think it's something towards like the Himalayas, maybe it's Tibet, maybe it's Nepal, maybe it's India. It's got all those sort of influences. So again, Gansu is not Tibet, but it's sort of music evocating that sort of region of China. And I felt that was sort of appropriate because Xuěmò himself, again, as far as I'm aware, he's Han Chinese, but he's dedicated himself to Gansu, which is, you know, that's not a Tibet, that's not a Xinjiang, but we're really far out away from the sort of the core of the Chinese nation, if there even is such a thing. I suppose it does have a bit of a spiritual feel, but really, I just love this song because I don't have an awful lot of Chinese music. So when I'm scrolling through a list of all my music, anything with Chinese characters for the names is going to get shoved at the bottom or the top of the alphabet. And a lot of them I just skip, but I usually stick this song on from this album because it's just excellent and I need to evangelize for it.
It reminds me of the movement of the Camels. Mm. I can see the Camels, actually almost from behind, I can see their movement as they sort of move side to side. So I thought it was really evocative of our journey.
That's right. I hadn't thought of that. But yes, it does have that sort of plodding sounds negative. I don't know what a positive way to say plodding is, but it's got that steady sort of rhythm.
What's the word? It's not wiggle, but it's something between a plod and a wiggle.
Swaying?
Swaying. It is swaying, yeah.
Yes, very swaying sort of song.
Yeah.
So yeah, I don't think there's anything deep I can say about that. I'll just take us on to the next question. So this is the bonus question for Patreon. So on the main feed, it'll sound like sped up. Blah, 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 okay. But if listeners want to hear the full thing, head on over to the TrChFic Patreon. There's hours and hours and hours and hours of stuff up there, and it's available for $1 a month. And if you're very naughty, you can pay for 1 month, download it all, and then cancel. And I still won't be mad because I got a dollar from that. So the question is, would you ever want to visit Gansu or any of the other harsh or arid regions, which tend to be in the sort of far reaches of China, so far from Shanghai? I think that concludes our bonus question. Ready for the wrap-up question? Should we move to those?
Yes.
All right. So the $3 million question. If listeners want to buy this audiobook, where should we send
them? Oh, right. Yeah. So, I mean, pretty much anywhere where they get their audiobooks. It's available on your Audibles, Google Plays, iTunes, audiobook.com. It's distributed very widely. It's also available for academics, or not necessarily academics, people who prefer to borrow rather than buy. It's available through libraries. So It's on Overdrive. It's on Bibliotheca. I think it's on a couple of other library platforms too, so it can be ordered through libraries. Yeah.
Wonderful. And last of the wrap-up questions, is there anything or anywhere else you'd like to direct the listeners to, or just anything we've not hit on that you'd like to hit on?
In terms of where to direct listeners to, if they want to find out more about Xuěmò, they could do a lot worse than going to the Leeds Centre for New Chinese Writing. Xuěmò was their author of the month for January. So you'll find one of his short stories, one that we haven't spoken about from the selected short stories, is on there in English and Chinese. And there's a little bit of biographical information. We are running, we've been quite active on a Twitter account about Xuěmò in February this year. And that's at Selected Xuěmò, and that's around the short stories, and it gives you some biographical background on Xuěmò, some links, some sort of contextual things, and that will stay up, so you know you don't have to look at it in February. You can look at it any time if you like. Xuěmò himself posts a lot of his thoughts, as in his sort of philosophical thoughts, on a Twitter feed which is at Xuěmò01. They're mostly in Chinese, but occasionally they're in English. He's also got a very good website that's in Chinese and in English, which is called xuemo.cn. So you can have a good old browse there on that. And then I think also Paper Republic have some brief information on him too. So obviously want to give them a shout out as well. So that's yes. the places where you can find bits of information. There's more, but, you know, those are the ones that I'm sort of conscious of that are active environments.
One thing I'd add is he's also on Instagram, or someone is running a Xuěmò Instagram. It seems like it's him or an assistant or something. And the Pinterest I mentioned earlier, I don't know how I stumbled across that, but there is a bilingual Xuěmò Pinterest, which I've never found for a Chinese author before.
That's interesting. And I wasn't aware of those, so I must look at them. I think we've sort of covered so much. Stop rustling papers. I think we've covered so much.
I think we have, yeah.
Yeah. And I'm just really pleased that Sarah was able to sort of bring a narrator's experience to the conversation. And her, it was just really lovely to discover when we started working together that she was a Buddhist. So she had a very interesting connection to the text.
Yeah, that's serendipity right there. Mm. Yeah. I think this is the point where I say thank you very much for coming on the show.
It was my pleasure. Thank you for having me on, and thank you for talking about the audiobook. It's sort of nice to have an opportunity to do that.
All right, we're reaching the end of the show. So I'll just say a really big thank you, not only to Nicola Clayton, who was there for the whole episode, but for Sarah Lam, who stayed with us for as long as she could. It was a really interesting chat. I love talking book production, as well as book writing, translating, editing. That's a perspective I find very interesting that I'd like to be hitting on more in the show. Now, if you had any thoughts, anything we said, if you'd like to send your, convey your opinion to me, and if you'd like something read out on the show as well, I suppose, then social media is a great way to get in touch. So we have an Instagram, it's at TrChFic, TrChFic. On Twitter, you can just follow or reach out to me, I'm at Angus Likes Words. There's a show Discord where you can share your thoughts or ask questions to the rest of the fans, or not all the fans obviously, but the ones who also are on that Discord. I guess that's all I'll say about the social media. One other plug I'll do is the show's Patreon. I thought I'd just talk a little bit about episodes that are queued up there for the future. So the next episode that is going to be coming out, it'll be on the 18th of March, is it's the bonus question from the Bajin episode where I asked Tianqi what she would ask Bajin if she can ask him any question. And then the next one queued up after that are my post-read thoughts on actually having read Family by Bajin, probably his most famous novel. So it's me talking for about half an hour solo about that novel. Then queued up after that, there's my bonus question that I asked Jenna Tang, that where she'd set a story if she could go to any time and place in mainland China. And then my next one, it's takes and musings, again sort of production thoughts, because it's a book I actually produced, Open Air Cinema by Su Tong. I worked in production and some other roles working on that book. So you can get a really inside view of that the latest book in translation, English translation, from Su Tong. And then queued up after that, we've got the bonus question from this episode. So there is a bit of a lag between these things. If I was smarter, I'd rejig the order, but I'm not smart. I'm not smart at all. There are so many bonus episodes. It must be coming up on 100 now, I think. You can get access to all past ones and all future ones by signing up as a patron. That is at least $1 a month, or you can contribute more if you want to be really lovely. But yeah, it's just a way to support the show financially, basically. Of course, there are many other ways to support the show. It's not all about money. And I'm of the opinion the best thing you can do is spread the word. Could be digitally, but, you know, I'm old-fashioned and wholesome. You know, those are synonyms for my name, really, wholesome and old-fashioned. And if you want to be wholesome and old-fashioned and spread the word, then tell your friends, tell your teachers, tell your camels, and tell the pack of dholes that are hounding you to an early grave in the cold desert sands. I don't know why the desert sands are cold. The deserts are famous for being hot, actually, but for whatever reason, that's where the dholes are hounding you to. So please do, before they catch you and rip you to shreds, spread the word about the show. It's the right thing to do with your life. And on that note, zaijian.